Hello, my name is Bishop Richard Henning, and I was hoping to have joined you this past Thursday evening for a holy hour and to offer some words of reflection. Unfortunately, the snowstorm intervened. We were not able to gather that night for prayer. But I'd like to offer for your reflection some thoughts on the Gospel of Mark. I chose the Gospel of Mark because this year, this cycle of the lectionary, we'll be hearing more from Mark. It's sort of the focus of year B in the cycle. What I'd like to do is, rather than kind of give a lecture on the characteristics of the gospel, is to examine some key passages or texts within the gospel in order to draw from that some of its unique genius and witness for us to reflect upon. So my goal is first, during the season of Lent, to offer you a resource for your own Lenten reflection, but secondly, maybe for you to go a little deeper into your understanding and knowledge of the Gospel of Mark as we hear from it over the course of this year. So the first thing I'd like to suggest to you is actually that it would be good, if you can, to simply take some time to read this gospel. Or, if you like to listen, get one of those apps that allow you to listen to this gospel on the phone. It's a rather short gospel, and as a result, it's easy enough to sit down and read it in about an hour, maybe just a little bit longer, or listen to it in an hour or hour and a half. There's a real value in listening to the whole of a gospel, because you really get a sense of the whole story in a way that you don't when you're listening to those individual passages. So let me leap in then to the Gospel of Mark. The first thing just to mention about the Gospel of Mark is that it is a gospel that is kind of in a hurry. Again, the briefest of our four gospels, and one that, at least in the Greek, uses the term immediately or right away over and over again. It's not always obvious in English translation because we tend to mix it up for stylistic purposes. But in the Greek, it's quite repetitive. Immediately this happened, then immediately that happened, then right away Jesus said this, or right away Jesus did that. So it's a relatively brief gospel. It's one that is, you know, has a very short time frame. So we actually don't hear the whole of Jesus' teaching and ministry in this gospel. And part of the reason for the shortness of this gospel is that it has a very clear focus on the suffering of the Lord. So some scholars call this gospel a passion narrative with an introduction. It's very focused on the mystery of the cross, and we'll see that in some of these passages. But if you look to the beginning of this gospel, again, kind of in a hurry, we don't even get any of the information about Jesus's birth. Rather, we hear right away about his ministry. The first thing that happens in this gospel is we hear a bit about the ministry of John the Baptist, particularly his preaching, laying the groundwork for the coming of the Messiah. And as soon as John is arrested, then we hear that Jesus' ministry begins. And listen here from chapter 1, verse 14 and 15. Now, after John was arrested, Jesus came to Galilee, proclaiming the good news of God and saying, "The time is fulfilled and the kingdom of God has come near. Repent and believe in the good news." So I'd like to focus our thoughts right now on that notion of the kingdom of God, or the reign of God, that has now drawn near. So the first thing that Jesus does in his ministry is let us know that God's power is close to us, that God's power is at work around us. Now, that truth is right there from the beginning, but we don't know yet what that truth really means, because, of course, in human settings, reign or power or kingdom, these have fairly specific meanings, meanings usually associated with control or domination. But yet Jesus is going to reveal how the power of God works differently than typical human expectations. And the first aspect of this difference is that the kingdom of God drawing near is both demonstrating or being demonstrated by the healings that Jesus does, as well as we're seeing, in effect, the content of the kingdom. So I'd like to point out that the healing that we see in this gospel, You could also call it reconciliation. Sometimes involves physical illness. Sometimes it involves Jesus's power over sin and evil. Sometimes it's a reconciliation of divisions among people. Sometimes it's the power of the Lord over death itself. I don't have time in my remarks to read to you all the passages I'd like to refer to. So I'm going to give you the passage settings and invite you, if you wish, to pause this video and take a moment to read the passage, if you wish, and then resume the video. So the first passage I'd like to speak about is a lengthy one, and this is in chapter 5, verses 21 to 43. So it's a healing. But it's a very important healing in this gospel. Again, a gospel in a hurry doesn't give us a lot of these stories, but this one is not only given to us, but given to us in some length. And it involves both a healing and a raising from the dead. So we have here a woman with a hemorrhage. We're told that she's been suffering from this illness for 12 years. And she approaches Jesus and touches his cloak. He realizes that she's there, and he announces to her that she has been healed, that her faith has healed her. Later, he's going to go to the house of Jairus, where Jairus' daughter has been very ill at the edge of death. By the time Jesus arrives there, she's already passed, and then he will raise her from the dead. What's very curious about these two stories, which are intermingled here in these verses, is that they both refer to the number 12. So we're told first the woman is ill for 12 years, then we're told that the child is 12 years of age. Now, whenever the gospel gives us a detail like that, it probably means something. And in this case, the meaning is really moving if you pay attention to it. So this woman's illness prevents her from giving birth. It has robbed her not only of her health, but of that God-given capacity to a woman to participate in the miracle of life. The child, 12 years of age, is at that point in her life before she reaches what would have been in those days marriageable age, and again, the possibility of being a mother. So what's really important here to note is that in both of these moments, the healing of the woman with the hemorrhage and the raising of the young girl, we have both of these women restored not only to life and to health, but restored to that capacity to participate in God's life-giving power. So even though we're talking here in a sense about physical healing, we're seeing something more than what has happened before, say, in the time of the prophets, who also worked miracles. What we have at work here is the very power of God to free people from their limits, to heal them, to raise them up, and of course, to draw them into that mystery of God who is the creator, who is the life giver. So very, very beautiful passage and well worth our reflection on this aspect of how the kingdom is being expressed. What does it mean when Jesus says the reign of God has drawn near? Let me point you in the direction of another passage. This is chapter 7, verses 24 to 30. Now here we have a little story of the healing of the daughter of the Syrophoenician woman. It's a somewhat unusual gospel story. Some people say it's the only gospel passage in which Jesus loses an argument. So here, this woman is a foreigner, and she comes to the house where Jesus is staying, and she begs Jesus to heal her daughter, in this case, from a distance. Her daughter is back in her house. And as we'll learn, her daughter is lying in a bed. Key little detail again. And that detail is important because it tells us that this woman, the Syrophoenician woman, is a wealthy woman. Only wealthy people in this period had beds to sleep in. Now, this is important because in this particular area where Jesus is traveling, in the vicinity of Tyre and Sidon, the overlords or the wealthy class, the landowners, are these foreigners, Syrophoenicians. But the peasants, the poor people that worked the land, were Jewish. And we know that these Jewish people were often mistreated by their wealthy elite and often insulted. And one of their favorite insults was to call their Jewish workers or peasants dogs, because this would be insulting for a person who saw dogs as unclean animals. And so when the woman comes to Jesus, he kind of pushes back at her, even as she asked for his help. He says to her, you know, you don't take the food from the children and give it to the dogs. It's a strange moment, isn't it, that Jesus would seem to lack compassion here for this woman who is in such great need and great anxiety about her little girl. And yet, what is Jesus really doing? Jesus is really reading the heart of this woman, and he's throwing back at her the very language that she might have used about others, derogatory language. Now notice that her response, if you read the passage, is one of humility. She accepts the insult and expresses humility, and of course then Jesus will heal her daughter, liberate her from the power of evil. It's a remarkable moment, and that healing communicates another important message, a message to Jesus' own disciples, who would have felt hatred and anger for these wealthy overlords who oppressed the Jewish people. And yet here is Jesus healing one of them. What we have here is not just the healing of the girl. We have, in a very real sense, the healing of divisions among people. Here's another aspect of the kingdom of God drawing near, that God's plan is coming to fulfillment. The Jewish people, chosen to be the light to the Gentiles, are now fulfilling that mission, that vocation, as Jesus himself now reaches beyond Israel to the nations, just as God had intended when he promised Abraham that his descendants would be that blessing to the nations. So another beautiful aspect of the healing that goes on here. So we're seeing here that Jesus has power over evil. There are a number of passages here where he casts out the demons. We see his power over physical illness. We see his healing of those divisions among people. It's a beautiful imagery of this kingdom of God drawing near. God's power is not domineering. God's power is not controlling. God's power is in the service of the good. God's power is reconciling and healing, filled with compassion. We see this too in the feedings, another expression of the kingdom of God drawing near. So we have two different miraculous feedings of crowds in this gospel, one in chapter 6 and another in chapter 8. The one in chapter 6 occurs with a Jewish gathering. The one in chapter 8 occurs with a mixed gathering of Jews and Gentiles. Again, that healing of that division. But in both cases, what do we see? We see Jesus's profound compassion for the people. And we see that compassion expressed very concretely in his care for them. Again, he's demonstrating that reign of God drawn near, and he's evoking the people's memories of what happened at Sinai with the manna from heaven. He's reminding them of God's providential care of his people, who fed them in the desert, who gave them water from the rock. Likewise, now Jesus, who is that visitation of the very presence of God, that reign of God now drawn near, performs this miraculous role of our Heavenly Father caring for his people with great compassion and love. Again, not control. This is not a leader who demands from others. This is a leader who serves the rest, who gives of himself. What matters here, as we note in this gospel that the kingdom of God is drawn near, is the nature of our response, because the gospel is challenging us to respond. Now, here we have to recall that in Genesis, God doesn't force Adam and Eve to remain in the garden. God gives to them freedom. And you might wonder, well, why is that? Of course, things didn't go so well, did they? But of course, you can't love if there is not freedom. And so God gives to Adam and Eve freedom. They misuse that freedom. But all God really hopes for and longs for from us is a response of love. And of course, in the Gospels, that will be modeled for us most profoundly by Jesus, who offers to our Heavenly Father that perfect love and trust that the Lord hungers and thirsts for. But he also continues to ask a response of us, certainly the folks here in the Gospel, but from us, because God does not exercise that reign by domination or control. It's in fact a kingdom of love, the power of love itself. And so the Lord hopes for our response. He won't force us to respond. So consider, for example, the story of the mustard seed. We have a number of seed parables in this gospel, but the mustard seed is the briefest, chapter 4, just two verses, 30 to 32. And here we learn that even the smallest amount of response on our part is multiplied by the Lord. Just as the loaves and the fishes are multiplied, anything we bring to God and offer to God in love and trust is going to be multiplied. A very powerful message for a Christian community that was suffering great persecution. They were tiny, they felt powerless, and yet what the Lord is saying to them is give of yourself, give that trust, and the Lord will bring new possibilities from that. We also have, in terms of response, a call to us to understand or perceive things in a new way. Certainly now to understand who Jesus is, but to understand this surprising aspect of the kingdom of God, that God is so different from us. So I point you to the eighth chapter of Mark's gospel, beginning in verse 26. We have the healing of the blind man of Bethsaida. And here it's interesting because as Jesus heals the man, there's kind of two stages. At first, on the surface, you might think, well, you know, Jesus's first attempt fails, and the man only sees partially, and then he heals him again, and then it works. But that's not actually what's going on. At a deeper level here, it's the man himself coming to sight. So the Lord's healing is at work in him, but he doesn't fully understand right away. He needs more time, more grace from the Lord. And very curiously, this passage immediately precedes the question that Jesus poses to his own disciples: who do you say that I am? And that moment when Peter responds with some insight, you are the Christ, but also misunderstanding as he objects when Jesus speaks about his destiny to suffer. And Jesus has to rebuke Peter. So Peter, like the blind man of Bethsaida, is getting it partly, but needs yet to come to greater depth of understanding, something that really can't happen in this gospel until you witness the passing of Jesus, the death of Jesus. Consider, too, the case of the story of the anointing in Bethany, chapter 14, verses 3 to 11. For here we have a woman who really gives her all to the Lord, another aspect of what's being asked of us in our response. This gospel is not asking us to simply take a list of rules to follow or prayers to recite or nice things to say about Jesus. This is a gospel that wants of us the same depth of response that Jesus himself offers, which is basically everything. Now, this is difficult for us as human beings. We find it very difficult to surrender ourselves really to the providence of God, but it's nothing less than that that is being asked of us, to trust that God loves us and is with us in all experiences, even through suffering and death, and to give ourselves completely to honor the goodness of the Lord Jesus, who is there with us as well. This same Jesus offers a series of teachings, and curiously, in this gospel, they are largely offered on the road to Jerusalem, and therefore, behind them is always that truth and mystery of the cross. So a couple of different stories here. The rich man that approaches Jesus in chapter 10, verses 17 to 26, and then the passage concerning ambition in chapter 10, 35 to 45. In both cases, the man who is unable to give up his riches in response to God, and the case of Jesus' own disciples who want to be given honors because they follow him, in both cases, our background is the truth that Jesus is literally walking towards the cross. And so it's his willingness to surrender everything, to trust completely, to offer himself without reserve that forms the background for both of these encounters and the teachings that are here, because they're tough teachings. Even the disciples object to the teaching that Jesus offers the rich man when he speaks about how it is more difficult for a rich man to enter the kingdom than for a camel to pass through the eye of a needle. These are tough teachings that demand something of us in terms of our response. But really what they're about is that capacity in response to the Lord Jesus to live in communion with him and to seek his grace and his grace alone, to trust and surrender ourselves and our ambitions. For as Jesus teaches us, He has not come to serve, to be served, but to serve. And likewise, he asks of his own disciples that they live in this same way. He goes on in chapter 12 to offer another teaching to them, the greatest commandment in verses 28 to 34, where he sums up really the whole of the law and the prophets as loving God and loving neighbor. Again, drawing us back to the meaning of that announcement of the kingdom drawing near. The power of God, the kingdom of God, the reign of God is really the power of love, the kingdom of love, the reign of love. And that, of course, brings us in this gospel to the events of the Passion, where Jesus is going to offer to his disciples, his apostles, another feeding, in this case, the feeding with his body and blood in the Last Supper. It's a very brief passage, just a few verses in chapter 14, verses 22 to 25. This is at the heart of this, not only this gospel, but really of the whole Christian message. For the New Testament itself is Eucharistic. The new covenant that is referred to in the New Testament is in fact, the phrase always refers to the Eucharist itself. And so here what we're seeing is, again, that gift of Jesus to our Heavenly Father for our sake. He is feeding us with his body and blood. He is preparing those disciples for his own self-offering. We also see in this gospel, in the death of Jesus, chapter 15, 33 to 39, a remarkable scene, very different than the other three gospels. Because here, there's a kind of loneliness, I think, to this particular account of Jesus' passing. My God, why have you abandoned me? He quotes the Psalms, which are, of course, an expression of his trust and his faith, but they express with us and for us that fear, that sense of abandonment, that difficulty for any one of us in the face of illness and death or the power of evil to stand at the edge of that abyss. It's difficult for us to trust. And so what do we see here in the Lord Jesus? We see that absolute gift of trust. He's been stripped of everything. He's been reviled and tormented and now even put to death. And yet he remains faithful and he trusts in the Lord. Again, the most powerful truth of the gospel, it's at the heart of the Eucharist and the faith itself, but certainly a model that challenges us in how we respond to God. And then with regard to the Passion, I'd like to mention one last part of the gospel, and that is in chapter 16, verse 8. So this is after Jesus' death and burial. The women have gone to the tomb, but notice that they leave the tomb in this way, verse 8. So they went out and fled from the tomb, for terror and amazement had seized them. And they said to one another, they said nothing to anyone, for they were afraid. Now, of course, these women are in fact going to go on and say something to someone, because otherwise we wouldn't be reading the gospel. And this gospel then has two kind of addendums that tell us a little bit more about Jesus' appearance after his resurrection. But the gospel story itself really kind of ends there. And it's realistic for us to see kind of the drama here. They say nothing to anyone for they're afraid. Death is overwhelming to us. It's frightening to us. And if they have not said anything to anyone because they're afraid, then what's the implication for the person that hears this story? It's that you or I now must raise our voices, because now we, having heard or read this gospel, we are witnesses to the grace of Jesus Christ, to the truth that in him, in his person, the kingdom of God is drawn near, that reign of love. And so the gospel kind of ends unfinished and asks us then now to step up and to do our part to announce and to live that truth of the gospel. I want to leave you now with one last passage. And to do this, I'm going to go back to the very beginning of the gospel. Because this passage is particularly dear to me. I think it kind of sums up the whole of this gospel. I told you in my beginning of my remarks that this is a passion narrative with an introduction. Again, so focused on the suffering face of the Lord Jesus, because of what that suffering represents, that other kind of power of God that is the power of love, to give life, to bring healing, to raise us up. And so I point you to the end of the first chapter of Mark, to the cleansing of the leper. Here we are in verses 40 to 45. So a leper comes up to Jesus, kneels down before him, says, "If you wish it, you can make me clean." Jesus reaches out and touches him, and he does, in fact, heal the leper. He instructs him to go back and to be restored to the community. He tells the man not to tell others about this miraculous healing, but the man ignores him, tells everyone, and now Jesus can't even go into the town. He ends up outside the town. Now, why is this passage so compelling? Well, remember the nature of leprosy in the ancient world. For ancient Jews, this is not just a terrible, physical, frightening illness. Indeed, it was, because not only were you sick and faced death, but you were disfigured terribly. But even worse than that, you were cast out from the worship of God. You were cast out even from your own family and home. You were like one already dead, still walking around. And so that's the state of this leper when he comes to Jesus. He is unclean. So he's not supposed to come anywhere near Jesus. But notice here at the start of the gospel, this is the first person that shows a little bit of insight into Jesus' identity, because he kneels down. He knows that Jesus is more than a prophet. He responds to Jesus as he would to the Lord, to God, God our Father. So he kneels down and he prays, basically, as he speaks to Jesus. Jesus' response is to reach out and touch him. Shocking moment, but deeply moving. Jesus is not supposed to touch him by the law. To do so means that Jesus takes upon himself that state of uncleanness. And yet the Lord chooses to touch him. He doesn't have to. We know already that Jesus can heal from a distance, as he did in the case of the daughter of the Syrophoenician woman. But he touches the man in compassion. He recognizes that man's humanity, and he takes upon himself the leprosy of the man, freeing the man from it and restoring him not only to health, not only taking away the disfigurement, but restoring this man to family, to life, to the joy of love of family and friends, and to the worship of God. It's a remarkable moment of restoration, but notice the effects of it. For now Jesus is the one out in the wilderness, cast out in the way that the leper had been. And if we think forward in this gospel to the moment of his suffering and death, he will be scourged, he will be disfigured, he will be made a horror to look upon, just as a leper was. And so what you're seeing here is the gospel in miniature. We are the leper. We are the ones who cannot save ourselves. We are the walking dead, marred and disfigured by sin and death. And the Lord touches out in compassion and love. He reaches out and touches us, lifting that from us, taking upon himself the effects of that sin, of that disfigurement, and in doing so, liberates us, restores us to life, restores us to one another, restores us even to ourselves, and restores us to our Heavenly Father. It's his great work of reconciliation. This is a passage worth reading again and again and again, because I hope it touches all of our hearts with the depth of grace and of God's love for us. Remember that it is at the death of Jesus, that self-offering that the centurion says in this gospel, "Truly this is the Son of God," far more than just even the Messiah, the very Son of God, the visitation of our Heavenly Father, the face of the God of love. I hope that for you and I during this season of Lent and throughout the year as we hear this gospel, that truth of Jesus' presence in our hearts and our lives will reach us, that we will know his healing touch, that we will rejoice in the restoration that he offers to us, and that we will ask of him the grace to do likewise, to ourselves trust and give of ourselves, to serve others, to see this truth of the way God's power is exercised, that power of love. So God bless you. Thank you for letting me spend these few minutes with you.